praise God. Good morning to you TV friends. We greet you in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. This morning, it's a good morning to be in your presence. This morning, we want to share from the Word of God. We're going to share from the book of Matthew chapter 1 and verse 21. Hallelujah. Permit me to read it. And it says, "And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins." Could we pray? Father, I thank you for your word. Father, you said that your word is forever settled in heaven. Father, you also said that the entrance of your word giveth light. So, Father, today as we discuss, Lord God, this message concerning your son, Father, I pray light come to the hearers in the name of Jesus. Amen and amen. This morning, the message is entitled, "Something About the Name Jesus." Hallelujah. I want to share with you about 5 points why I think the name Jesus is important. Let us start off with the importance of a name. I was told that my name is Curtis Collins. When I got a little older, I looked up the meaning of the word Curtis, and I realized that there is meaning to names. Every name have a meaning. There is a purpose for every name. So in my research, I found out that the name Curtis means courteous. And sometimes that name will be put to the test. I remember one Saturday morning at the market car park, I was waiting my turn to get into a park. In fact, the driver ahead of me was backing up. And I was there patiently waiting to slip into that park. But just before I could slip into that park, another driver came and rushed into that park. Same park that I was aiming for. And right there and then, it came to me. Curtis, your name means courteous. It's the same thing with God. When God gave Jesus the name, there is a meaning behind the name. Jesus was not just a name picked out of a hat. Jesus was not just a name that Mary came up with. But the name Jesus has significant meaning for us today. I realize that a lot of people will use the name Jesus Christ even as a curse word. But my friend, there is more to the name of Jesus than being used as a curse word. In fact, names are so important that even in the book of Genesis chapter 17 and verse 5, the Bible tells us about Abraham. In fact, the Bible called him in those early days Abram. And in order for Abram to inherit the promise of a son, the Bible tells us there in Genesis, and permit me to read it. It says, "Neither shall thy name any more be called Abram, but thy name shall be Abraham, for a father of many nations have I made thee." The name that one is called by is very important. Some of us give our children all kinds of names. And when we come and we realize that, hey, because of the attitude of this child now, or because of the behavior of this child now, he is acting out or reflecting exactly what his name means. Therefore, when Mary was told that you're going to bring forth a son, the angel did not leave it to chance. God did not leave it to chance and say, "All right, Mary, you're going to name him whatsoever." The Bible tells us that the angel told Mary that thou shalt call his name Jesus. And what I like about that is that the name Jesus stands for a lot of things. One of them that I need to mention to you is that the name Jesus, it stands for Savior. For in fact, in the same scripture, it says the name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. You may say that, how can that apply to me? You see, according to what the word of God says, that all of us were born in sin. Sir, from the time you were born, the Bible tells us that you came into this world seeing sin. That sin is a part of your nature. Therefore, something needs to be done. I could take you all the way back to Genesis when man sinned. The Bible tells us that sin passed upon all flesh. Not some. This is not a matter of whether your father and mother were married. No, it has nothing to do with that. It doesn't matter if you were born into a wealthy family or a poor family. Sir, it doesn't matter. What matters is that man was in sin. In fact, man was created perfect, but he fell into sin. And God needed to solve this sin problem. You think that the problems that we have in our world today is because of economics or because of somebody don't like you? Sir, the problem, the biggest problem in our world today is sin. Therefore, God, seeing it in his wisdom, decided that there should be a man called Jesus. And his purpose is to save. In fact, Jesus himself said, I come to seek and to save that which is lost. Today, we notice that how our world is going. We notice how, and we can sit back and take note of what is going on in our world today. It seems like things are getting worse. It seems like things are so bad that there is no answer. But I'm here to tell you today, the answer was given over 2,000 years ago by that man called Jesus. For he came to seek and to save. Today, you may be in an area of your life that you need saving. I don't know what area it is. I don't know if it's a physical problem you need saving from. But what I know is that that man with the name Jesus has the power to save from sin. And let me just emphasize a little bit. The Bible tells us without the shedding of blood, there is no remission for sin. I've known that people to go to churches. In fact, people have told me that, hey, I was born in this particular religion. And I'm going to die in that particular religion. But sir, if you don't trust in Jesus, who is the only one that can save you from sin, it makes no difference what religion you belong to. Because Jesus and Jesus alone can save. Jesus and Jesus alone is given the authority to save. In fact, my mind goes straight to one story about in the New Testament when it talks about a crippled man being saved and being healed. And Jesus said, thy sins be forgiven thee. And the priest got up and said, who gives you authority to forgive sins? And that big discussion broke out. They wanted to take the life of Jesus there and then. But note, that name that was given unto him says that he shall save his people from their sins. As I was saying, the blood of Jesus is so important because the bulls and the goats and the turtle dove, they could have only covered sin for a period. Mankind's problem is not that only we have a covering for a period. But the thing about it in the book of Deuteronomy and onwards, it tells us of the sacrifices that were made to atone for sins. From ever since man fell in the Garden of Eden, God and man was trying to get back together. They tried, in fact, in the book of Genesis, with the sacrifice of Cain and Abel. You realize that Cain was making a sacrifice, but that sacrifice was not pleasing to God. Just like men today, they are trying all kinds of things to sacrifice for their sins. But when the eyes of God is just not meeting up without the shedding of blood, and Abraham proved that, hey, what the sacrifice that God needed back then was the shedding of blood. Therefore, the Bible tells us when the fullness of time was come, sent from God, made of a woman, made under the law to redeem them which are under the curse of the law. You see, the time had to be right. Moses seeked her. In fact, let's start with Abraham. Abraham seeked for a promise. Moses looked for a Messiah. And name them all through the Bible history. Men were looking for the answer. In fact, Israel always looking for the Christ. When he came, the Bible tells us he came in humility. Expecting, in fact, the wise man expected that Jesus would have been born in a castle. Or in a prince palace. They came searching for him, but they searched in the wrong place at first. Jesus came lowly, and I'm glad that he did. Because if he had come to the palace, maybe the rich would have said that, hey, Jesus is for us. I'm glad that he came in a stable, very humble. So everybody, not only the poor, but the rich also can claim that that name Jesus was given to save me from my sins. The Bible tells us that that name also, in fact, in the book of Acts, hear what it says. Neither is there salvation in any other. You see, a lot of people look for salvation in other names. A lot of times we look for salvation. Sometimes we look to the United States as a nation for salvation. We look to kings for salvation. We look to priests for salvation. But there is no other, there is salvation in no other. No other name given under heaven whereby man can be saved. That name that is declared in the book of Matthew is that name and only that name that salvation could be brought. My mind goes also because, in fact, the name Jesus, I consider it a very important name. Hear why I consider it a very important name. Because in the book of Philippians chapter 2 and verse 10, it tells us, at the name Jesus, every knee shall bow. Watch me. Things in heaven and things beneath the heaven. So everything can bow. Therefore, I submit to you that there is also power in the name of Jesus. I always say when I'm preaching that the chief secretary has power. And the thing about it is sometimes when you go to him, he is willing to exercise some power to bring you relief. But it's not all the time he can. The power that Jesus has, the Bible says, every knee shall bow. Not some, not maybe a few, but he has all power. All power is given unto him according to the word of God in heaven and in earth, even under the earth. The Bible tells us that Jesus Christ, he has all authority. I don't know what your problem is. And you may be looking for a name. Sometimes you may be looking for a solution in some other. In fact, in the book of Revelations, it tells us that who can open the seals. And I think it's Revelations chapter 5. And it tells you, hey, they searched all over and could not find somebody who has the authority, who has the ability to loosen a seal. But I know that according to Revelation, it says the Lion of the tribe of Judah, referring to Jesus Christ, Christ, that same name prevails, and not only prevails, he prevails to loose every chain, break every seal. Jesus Christ has the power. Some people think that this Jesus name that we use is slight. It has no real effect. But sir, I can tell you, when I was in my troubles, I called on that name. When I was in my despair, I called on that name. In fact, God promised you, he said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. That same man with that same great name, Jesus, he said he will not leave you. So I called upon him. The Bible tells us that only that he has so much a power that everything is given unto him. You think your problems is hard? You think your burdens is too heavy? Jesus himself says, come unto me all ye that labor and are in heavy laden. You see, Jesus also gives you the opportunity to come. He wants to carry your load. That man Jesus, that man with that great name Jesus, he wants to deliver you. There's another point I want to make. It's about the name Emmanuel. That's another name that we could refer to. In fact, in the book of Matthew chapter 1 and 23 tells us, and they shall call him his name Emmanuel. Interpreting God with us. Isn't it good to realize or know that, hey, God is with you? At times we may feel that we are all alone. But the man with the great name, the man with the important name, the man with the powerful name, it's very important to know that God is with you. God is with you. That name is very important because I need to know when I'm going through my struggles, when I'm going through my testing, I need to know that God is with us. Therefore, the name Emmanuel. In fact, people will call him Emmanuel. And in fact, in the Old Testament, one of the prophets says that, hey, his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, Prince of Peace. If you're looking for peace today, you need to know that God is with you. Therefore, the peace of God is with you. You need to know also, as in the book of Proverbs chapter 18 and verse 10, the name of the Lord is a strong tower. You need to know that the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The Bible says the righteous run in and they are saved. Today we need saving. Yes, I don't know if your economic situation and you need saving from, but the Bible tells us that the name of the Lord is a strong tower. I looked at some towers just this week. I had the privilege of going into one of those old sugar mill tower. And I took the time to look at the construction. And it's some 22-inch brick that they placed together, one on top of each other. I don't know how they did it because they didn't have the tools like what we have today. And just referring to that tower is well built. I remember some earthquakes that passed a few years ago and it took down one of our big buildings. In fact, it shook it so strong that it had to be torn down. And I looked at that tower. And after all these earthquakes, after hurricanes and rainstorm, that tower still stands. The Bible says that the name of the Lord is a strong tower. Not only a tower, but a strong tower that the righteous can run into and be saved. Today, you need a tower for safety. Trust in that name. You need a tower for strength. You need to trust in that name, because there is no other name that promises what that name promises. There is no other name that promises the protection that that name promises. The righteous shall run into it and be saved. You look at towers. In fact, towers are built for protection. Some people said that the tower that the Israelites threw down by a shout at the walls of Jericho was so wide that more than one chariot can race on top of it. Towers are built to protect cities. Towers are built to protect as a form of defense. Jesus Christ can be your defense. He is. That name is a strong tower. As I bring this whole thing together, I need for you to understand that Jesus Christ is the one that you need to trust in. Some of us trust in chariots, some of us in horses. But as the psalmist says, I will trust in the name of the Lord. Sir, the name of the Lord, madam, is the only one you can trust in. Some of you trusted in your wives and husbands. And today you say, I regret because I put all my trust in him. Some of you all trusted in your children. But you say, hey, what can I do now? They have gone and left me alone. But I can say to you, it's not too late to trust in the name of Jesus, which is a strong tower. Which is the only tower of strength, that name Jesus. You can call upon that name. You can lean upon that name. He is a friend. You see, it's good to know that you know somebody in high office. But when that person knows you, it makes a difference. That Jesus Christ, he wants to be your friend today. That man with that important name wants to be your friend today. Yes, that Jesus, same Jesus. That same Jesus also made a promise. He said, I will come again. Listen, the same Jesus I've been describing, that same Jesus said that he will come again. And if that Jesus says that he will come again, believe you me, I believe with all my heart that he will come again. In fact, he said, I will come and receive those who trust in me to myself. Are you one of those? Are you one of those who trust in this name? I've heard stories about men when they are sick. They say, Jesus, if you heal me, I will trust in you. And after God heals you, you will turn your back on him. You will go away because that was just for a season. You just wanted to just lean upon him because you wanted help. But the thing about it is that Jesus don't only want to be a part-time helper. He wants to help you all the time. But you need to put your full trust in this name. You need to put all your trust in the name of Jesus. Today, friends, this Jesus, as I said, he's going to come again. And I know for a fact that I've put my trust in him. Have you put your trust in this Jesus? You need to this morning. You need to put your trust in him. As I am about to wrap this message up, let me give you an invitation to serve this Jesus. To believe in this name Jesus. You see, I believe that you need to know and understand the power of this name, the deliverance that is in this name. So if you don't know him as Lord and Savior, this morning is your morning to know this Jesus. This morning is your morning to trust this Jesus. I want to pray with you. I want to pray for you. Right where you are, you could lay your hands on the television. If you can't, just stretch your hand towards this television. I want to pray for you because I believe that this same Jesus can save you. This same Jesus has the power to save you. Bow your heads with me as I pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, you see this man, you see this woman. You see this little boy or this girl, Lord God, that believes now that you are who you say you are. You are the Christ. In fact, one of your disciples says, the Son of the living God. So, Father, this morning, as they believe with me, I pray, Lord God, that your salvation be turned real in their lives. That you, Lord God, will come into their lives right now in Jesus' name. If you believe with me, just say this prayer with me. Lord Jesus, come into my life. Make me a new person. Cleanse me from all sin. And make me whole. If you repeat that, in fact, the Bible said, by your confession, salvation is wrought. So this morning, I just want to pray for you as we go. Father, in the name of Jesus, Father, I pray, Lord God, as your word went forth, that it will not return void, but it must and will accomplish all it sent forth to do. Father, have your way in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. God richly bless you until another time. Praise God.
This program comes to you compliments of the Tobago Inspirational Network. To support this and other programs, we encourage you to give to TIN. Contributions can be made at any First Citizens Bank at account number 203-4679. We thank you for your support.